John Berthoud, president of the National Taxpayers Union Foundation. For 20 years, we've hosted our National Taxpayers Conferences, and these conferences are an opportunity to bring in activists from all over America. In 2007, we brought in 400 folks from the U.S. and actually from around the world, and gave them an opportunity to network, to learn, and hopefully get inspired in their fights for freedom and lower taxes where they live and the communities where they live. In a few minutes, you're going to hear from some of them about what they've been working on, the fights they're fighting, and how they're going about doing that. We've also interspersed some clips from some of our conference speakers, which I think you're going to enjoy. During the 20 years of our conferences, our conference alumni have been involved in almost every single state and local tax fight around the country. And we, as you'll see in a few minutes, the conference attendees this year are writing history as we speak. I think you'll enjoy the video, and I think you'll also enjoy our website, ntu.org, which I hope you'll visit after you watch the video. Our website will give you easy opportunities to get involved, and we'll also give you information about what's going on in your state and locality. So I hope you enjoy the video, and hope to see you at our website, ntu.org. Thanks.
The most important thing that we did in Arizona this last election cycle was pass a measure on eminent domain and regulatory takings, which passed by 65%. Basically, what our initiative did was protect eminent domain from being taken for anything other than a true public use. We defined that as not being taken from one private party to be given to another private party for economic development. That is a taboo. We also redefined blight. So blight is no longer an area. It has to be parcel by parcel, which stops developers from coming in and condemning with the city and collusion with the city whole neighborhoods.
We're excited about projects we have going on all over the country. Recently, our Florida chapter, for example, was instrumental in preventing a rollback of a citizens' initiative passed term limit provision that the legislature was trying to force through. They're also very active in Tabor project. Some of our members up in Maine have been very successful with real ID limitation, and we have similar successes all over the country.
We've at the Tennessee Center for Policy Research are focused on a lot of state issues as well, such as our state surplus, $1.7 billion this year. Hardly any of it was returned to taxpayers. But they also, on top of the surplus, increased taxes. They put in a 42-cent tax increase on cigarettes. So we certainly have out-of-control government spending, and we're watching out for that.
Today because of some of us process language in a different culture, that's Spanish. Aquí estoy este día para decirle a ustedes, señores, señoras, abuelitas y abuelitos, que donde está todo su dinero, se paga todos los días en taxes, y sabemos que les quitan mucho dinero. Si usted quiere saber dónde va ese dinero y por qué es tanto dinero le están sacando de sus salarios, por favor, hay muchos grupos en los Estados Unidos, taxpayers, especialmente el uso de Corpus Christi, Texas. Y tenemos un grupo allí y por favor los invitamos, no más en Corpus Christi, pero en toda la nación tenemos muchos grupos. Por favor, edúquese, porque es muy importante. Usted puede hacer una diferencia. ¿Dónde se va a ir sus dineros en taxes? ¿Sabe usted? Puede hacer una diferencia. Gracias.
Recent victories was just this last November, where we beat a statewide parcel tax. We had the largest margin of victory of any of the statewide measures. That was Prop 88, and we're now looking forward to doing a property rights initiative. It was very good to hear Governor Gilmore this noontime, and he's launching a property rights effort, and we are looking at the June of 08 ballot to qualify an initiative, and we're securing the funding for that right now, and it looks actually quite positive.
Seventh budget we're working on right now. I'm part of the thin red line that are standing in the way of our governor and the Democrats in the Senate, who have a majority there, from raising our taxes by about $2 billion.
Right at the moment, we're working on market value assessment and all the detriments of market value assessment, how it's taking people's property away from them. And we've been somewhat successful. We've been able to force an investigation of the property tax assessment within Ontario, and through the Ombudsman's office, he came up with this report, and it was not a glowing report at all about market value assessment. On top of that, we were able to force the government into a two-year freeze on any increases in market value assessment. They figured that their semi-government organization would take 2 years to change everything around. In actual fact, since I worked for them for 30 years, it should only take no more than 3 months. But there's a political election coming up on October the 10th, and so they decided that they'll defer any decisions until after the election, and we're going to be ready for them.
Yesterday, we presented 5,000 names, a 5,000 petition to the government, to Downing Street, against local taxes. And this is called our Brown Envelope campaign. We got people to photocopy their local council tax return, write a letter to Gordon Brown, who's the Chancellor in the UK, and send it to us so we could present it to him to campaign against local taxes. All right. And I think the key lesson from this is that when the boss goes away, the campaign does very well, because we had Sky there, we had BBC there, it was covered in all the national papers, so they did a fantastic job whilst I've been in the US.
Working on our mandate is lower taxes, less government waste, more government accountability, and a lot of what we do is democratic reform as well as hopefully tax reform and lowering taxes. One of the things we've seen most recently is the election of a new prime minister, a conservative prime minister, although he has a minority government, which is something that Americans don't usually have to deal with, a bicameral two-party system. We have multi-parties and he has a minority government. But he has been successful in pushing Senate reform. We have an appointed Senate in Canada where the Prime Minister chooses all the senators. Very undemocratic, and it's a complete waste of money. Many Canadians want to see it abolished. We want to see it either elected or abolished. And he has moved to make that provinces will elect their own senators. So it's a step in the right direction, something we're very excited about. We're also excited about some tax relief we have seen. We have seen, unfortunately not in the vein of the fair tax, we actually saw a reduction in our general goods and service tax, our sales tax. While it is tax relief, we will take it, and we are happy with that. Although we remain to be a very overtaxed nation, we have a massive half a trillion dollar debt for a fairly small country. And in fact, since our budget has been balanced, we've seen $95 billion in surplus in the last little over a decade, yet very little in terms of tax relief. So we're still fighting for a lot more tax relief.
I've actually just been back to Denmark launching a book about why the low-tax American system is better than the Scandinavian model of high taxes and high government spending.
And is this a bestseller yet? This seems like it would be popular idea.
It's getting there. It's sold 50% in the first edition in 1 week, and hopefully within the next year or so, you'll have lots of Danes coming over to look at low taxes in America.
And what do you rate the chance of success at lowering taxes in Denmark to be?
I think people have to be educated, but then it'll happen, and I think that a lot of what NTU does can be of inspiration to the Danish voters.
And what average tax rate are Danish citizens looking at?
Well, if you want to buy a car, you have to pay a 180% sales tax, for instance. Typically, you'd pay 50% in income taxes. The marginal tax rate is 60%.
Wow. This should be a very popular book. Good luck with the project.
Thank you.
History is the sum total of the ideas and the actions of individual men and women who get up every day and decide what history is going to be. And so, I'm just delighted to be here with all of you. And I just hope that we all remember this role that we play. We're empowered more now than ever before in our history to make sure that the history that we create every day, day in and day out, and especially in the election cycles that are coming up, our history based on freedom, because if so, it'll be a history of the prosperity and opportunity that only comes from freedom. So thank you for all that you do.
Coolidge had a lot to say about taxation. And recall, he left office with a surplus. One of my favorites comes from his inaugural address on March 4, 1925. The collection of any taxes which are not absolutely required, which do not, beyond reasonable doubt, contribute to the public welfare, is only a species of legalized larceny. The wise and correct course to follow in taxation is not to destroy those who have already secured success, but to create conditions under which everyone will have a better chance to be successful. That is why the National Taxpayers Union serves as a valuable and much-needed watchdog in Washington, and why I find it a reliable and essential resource to keep an eye on these characters whose only convictions seem to come in court. Thanks for the time.
I never thought I'd be pushing so hard for them to put earmarks in bills. But I guess it's better than keeping them out and then adding them in the conference report. But then later today, they've thought better of it, I guess, and they're off the deal. I wondered, as Boy Scouts, I'm a Boy Scout counselor, and I often have Boy Scouts coming over and writing letters to their congressman. They get a merit badge for that, citizenship of the nation. And I'm wondering if that's what we get as well. We write, we might not get satisfaction, we might just get a merit badge. But I think it's a pretty bad trade to trade in your voting card as a member of Congress for the ability to write a letter and complain about an earmark.
We're going to know what to do right this time. And part of that is getting rid of earmarking and turn money back over to people in the states and get the federal government out of trying to manage every aspect of our lives. So we'll keep fighting that fight. And the ultimate result of less spending, as you know, gets back to your main subject, which is keeping taxes low. The other thing we need to do is to force to the forefront tax reform, real tax reform. And we've got to keep talking about a simpler tax code, a more transparent tax code, where people know how much taxes they're paying, and it will put more pressure to keep taxes low. The way it is now, people don't know how much taxes they're paying, it's coming out of their paycheck, and the whole process is so confusing. I don't think it's complicated. I think all our problems come from the fact that we have little, if no, respect for the rule of law, and that is the Constitution. And we can solve a lot of our problems, whether it's the monetary policy, whether it's the foreign policy, or the entitlement system, by doing something very simple, and that is following the Constitution. Take our oath of office very seriously, and don't vote for these programs that are unconstitutional. And I think the American people are waking up to this. I think they asked us to do that in 1994, and we didn't do a very good job. They asked for it again in the year 2000. And we haven't done the job. And the Republicans really got hurt last year. And I think it's because we have failed on the promises to shrink the size of the government. I don't want to just slow up the growth of government. I want to actually shrink the government, and I want to shrink it significantly so that we can live with our needs.
What we're trying to do is be about, as I think Senator Goldwater once said, we're supposed to be about the business of liberty, about the empowerment of people, about giving people more rights and opportunities and chances to be more independent within their own society. And this goes to the heart of tax policy, which is why, John, I was so happy to be invited to be here today. Tax policy and controlling spending and tax cuts for people have been at the heart of my public life, my entire life. It is the essence of liberty. I'm gonna just say it and then move on quickly. If you take money away from people which they have earned, you drain away their capital, and that depreciates the opportunity for them to be more independent and to have their own savings accounts and their own retirement accounts and their own ability to put down a down payment so they can leverage capital and maybe get into business and be more independent.
Now, this is very, very important, because if a government raises its revenue unfairly, then the people who are part of the polity, who are governed by this government, recognize that they will not be treated fairly in anything else the government does. And the United States of America treats taxation revenue unfairly. And so what is the consequence of that? It's very straightforward. People lack confidence in the government, and they resent paying taxes. People, if they know that they're going to get value for taxes, just like when they're going to buy something of a personal nature, they're prepared to pay that. But they don't think they're getting value, and I can tell you, after 16 years of elective office, they don't get value.
You are engaged, we are engaged together in the greatest human rights effort of our time. The effort to win protection for the people and the people's income and the people's property against the unlimited taking of governance. And future generations will thank you for the work you are doing.